At Deloitte, we've been following the evolution of e-mobility and green cars for several years through specific research. We have become experts in this field. Our research shows that company fleets can benefit strongly from the new technology and achieve CO2 targets and total cost mobility reduction through the integration of electric vehicles. We had been a satisfied Alphabet customer for many years with several hundred cars under management. When we saw the quality and product range that Alphabet was setting up for this e-mobility solution, we knew we had found a strong partner, a partner with a common goals to move towards a greener future together.
Alpha Electric is the first holistic e-mobility solution to guarantee a simple integration of electric vehicles of all makes into company fleet. Easy and effective.
With Alphabet's electrification potential analysis, we were able to set up a driving profile of our fleet. We found that 30% of existing fleet could be replaced by electric cars. We've already started using electric cars and they are popular with both young managers and senior executives. Waiting time for taxis, congestion charges and city parking fees need to be minimized. With Alphabet's corporate car sharing solution, Alpha City, this is ensured.
By combining Alpha City and Alpha Electric, we achieve lower CO2 emissions, reduce cost, and improve services for Deloitte's consultants and customers.
We appreciate our long-lasting partnership with Deloitte and look forward to many years of successful cooperation to come.
People still think e-mobility is complicated. With Alpha Electric, Alphabet has proven that e-mobility is easy and convenient.
We can all look forward to a bright e-mobility future.
Hello, my name is Fraser Crichton. I'm the Fleet Manager for Dundee City Council, and I'm going to present to you today my 10-year journey to change the city of Dundee to e-mobility. The first slide here is showing you, I always put this one up because it represents what's not just going on in the transportation of the city, it's what's happening in the entire whole city. And this is quite important because it's basically showing you that the whole city is evolving and changing, because the key word is to change. So what you have here is the V&A Museum on the left-hand side, the centre of the city, and the new railway station. All of those things are part of a £1.1 billion regeneration of the waterfront, which has taken place over 30 years. And it's roughly through halfway through it. As I say, I'm highlighting that because the whole city is evolving from a very industrial city in the 50s, 60s, up to the end of the 1970s. On the bottom screen is probably more apt, which is showing you some of the advancements, just a generic overview, one of the largest council fleets in the councils of the UK. I'm sitting roughly at about 180 vehicles at the moment. I think I'll surpass 220 to 250 by April next year, which is quite significant. Also significant is 24% of all the taxis in Dundee are 100% electric. And on the left-hand side, I've left that one for the last, which is showing you an overview of the city, which is very significant in that it was a volcanic seat. And you can see that there. And what happened is that the volcano, many years before I was born, we built our roads on those lowest points. So whereas in most cities in the world, what you have is between 8 and 9 in the morning and 4 and 5 at night, you have peaks pollution in your city. Unfortunately, because of this topography that I'm showing you here, that air pollution can't escape anywhere. So therefore, it just sits as a smog and goes nowhere. So way back 10 years ago, the options that I had were to either bulldozer this city flat, which obviously was quite difficult, to say the least, or I could then go in and change the transportation. So I went for the latter, and obviously another factor, and you'll see the significance of that, over 120,000 charging sessions took place last year. Next slide basically shows you, I always have to put this one in because I do quite a lot of these presentations around Europe, etc. And I know that Dundee is similar to Dublin, but it is Dundee in Scotland that I'm from. So I always put this little thing up. But significantly, why I put this one up is that the area. So we're 13 kilometres by 2.5 kilometres, which is an extremely condensed area. We have 150,000 people. So, you know, that's quite significant, especially for early adoption, because, you know, when the electric vehicles were coming out first, 50, 60 miles, that was all they could do. However, we could still put operations into the city, given that knowledge. The next slide, again, shows another reason why I had to then change to e-mobility, because when we looked at most cities in the UK, looked at different areas for air quality management where we're having difficulties, as already highlighted, we have the whole city is unfortunately a pollution hotspots, and we made the entire city an air quality management area. Now, at the time, I was kind of going, oh my God, that's a nightmare. But in actual fact, when you're putting a strategy together, when you're looking to put e-mobility into the entire city, it is very helpful when you realise that we've got to tackle the whole city and not just parts of it. At the very top there, you see the Scottish Government. I know in the UK, the government went for 2040, but Scottish Government, I don't look this old for nothing. The 8 years have taken off of the expectation to try and move over to e-mobility, so that 2032. So again, a bit of pressure on there, but then it's another exciting target to meet. On the right-hand side, that's shown you just one thing that unfortunately Dundee also has as a first. The last actually 3 years, we've got the highest MOT failure rate in the city. Nothing to do with anything I've just said. It's just, I think it's poor mechanics and on old vehicles on the roads. But again, it's challenging. It makes the situation for the air quality very difficult. Okay, so this slide shows you, right, this is where we started. I started, as I said, 10 years ago. It was quite simple. It was looking at my own fleet, trying to lead by example. The council, the bottom slides show you our headquarters where we're putting our carpools. We took out combustible cars, put in electric vehicles. And again, what you're looking at there is then 3,500, 4,000 drivers using the carpools, getting them used to electric vehicles, and then really getting understanding the infrastructure, which is EV infrastructure, which is obviously extremely key to this e-mobility development. And a rule of thumb that I kind of got in my head, if you have more than 8 cars in a depot, for argument's sake, or vehicles, I tend to try and look to put a 50 kilowatt charger, a rapid charger in it, because I mean, even as I'm talking just now, people have been putting diesel in petrol engines and petrol and diesel engines. So to think that they can then get the cable and make sure it's charging 100% right all the time and leave it overnight, it's a big ask, to be perfectly honest. So you need to have some sort of backup where when you turn up for an operation to go to a meeting, etc., you might find the car is just about empty. Well, you need this backup here. And that's where the kind of rule of thumb is have a rapid charger in sort of significant depot infrastructure like this. And then as we move on to the next slide, then we started to develop not just our own fleet, an understanding that, yes, I can do this, we're leading by example, but how do we actually change a city? How do you manage to get all the vehicles that everybody knows is in their cities to electric vehicles? A huge task, but without infrastructure, it's never going to happen. So, as you can see, we've put infrastructure across the city, quite a lot of rapid chargers, single rapid chargers, and then slower chargers and depots, slower chargers. And that's now combined with the NHS, with the universities, and with the police, etc. But we quickly understood that certain sectors, there's two big keys to starting to build hubs. And you can see them in the big circles. We've built these three hubs, and I'm going to show you them in a minute. But the key to this was that the taxi industry was a big polluter in the city, and they're not going to go home, let's put it bluntly. They're not going to go home between fares to get a charge. They need rapid charging. So strategically, we spoke to them and said, where would you like these hubs to be built of fast chargers? And the other significant factor was 51% of the population of Dundee don't have driveways. So they're not going to be charging at home either. So, you know, we had to come up with another solution, and the charging hubs were what we came up with. And on the next slide, it kind of developed, especially around the taxi industry, showing you what we had to do for the region. So a classic example of that would be a taxi driver would say to me, Fraser, what if I get a fare to London from Dundee? Now, I responded to saying, do you ever get a fare to London? No, but I might. But what his point maybe was that he gets fares outside Dundee, really. And I got that and thought, right, okay. So we went to the local authorities round about us and said, could we put in what I call dumbbells, but they were really rapid charging stations, so that if they did get fares out there, they knew that the other end of where they were dropping off the people that picked up, they knew if they run out, they would get a charge there. So that started us developing a regional infrastructure. That led to putting in infrastructure in the local hospitals, through the NHS, and also other strategic sites where the local authorities like it. So basically we were organising out, expanding out the infrastructure. And again, putting Perth, for example, put that rapid charger hub there, as you can see on the left-hand side. And it was based on what we'd done already. So that's the regional infrastructure. So the next slide, and probably one of the most significant slides is, and especially if anyone else is listening from other councils, is that what you see here is John Alexander, our council leader in Dundee City Council. Now he actually is, I think, is the youngest leader of any administration in the country. I could be wrong there, but I think he is. And quite significantly, as you can see, in August 2018, he traded in his two petrol cars, his and his wife's, and they went out and bought this two-year-old Nissan Leaf. And basically he did that to say, look, this is the direction of travel the council are going. This is what I'm doing. I'm leading by example. And just to try and encourage everybody to go forward. Now, he has talked about this, driving this car about the city and other surrounding area, and he absolutely loves it. So if you've got, as a transport manager like myself or any other sort of officers in a council, if you know that your leader is backing you 100%, it makes such a difference when you go to change in the city and everything that I'm showing you here today. Okay, so here's Princess Street EV Hub. What we can see here is a site which has got 650 kilowatts rapid chargers, 322 kilowatts here on the very bottom there. And obviously you can see solar on top of everything. And that solar is roughly about 40 to 45 kilowatts it generates a day. It feeds what you can see on the left-hand side. You see beside the Tesla, the white box, which has got Second Life Renault batteries installed there. And that can take a capacity of 90 kilowatts. So obviously what you can see there is it can't charge all the vehicles if they turn up there in one go. However, it works out that the most advantageous time to release that charge out of those battery storage units, which normally is 8 and 9 o'clock in the morning when all the taxis have done their school runs, they all come in there. That's when it kicks in and it peak shaves really against the tariffs. And then what you find is over the winter time, where it's slightly colder in Scotland at times, the taxi industry come in that little bit earlier. And after a couple of days, that system works that out. Quite significantly here, though, what we have is a capacity. We've got 1,000 kVh substation. Roughly when this is going full pelt, it's only taking roughly about 300 to 320 kilowatts. So that just shows you the capacity is here, so we can expand it. And what we're looking to do on all the hubs that we've built is put 150 chargers in now, due to the fact that the industry, the motor industry, are starting to have batteries that can take that sort of capacity. So the third hub, which moving on to the next slide, it shows you what we call now is a multimodal EV hub. And on the top left, you can see there is the charging infrastructure, similar to what you've just seen. But here we've developed this, and we've got 40,000 vehicles coming into the city on a daily basis from outside the region. And what many cities are grappling with this, which is a low emission zone in the city centre. So what we don't want is the cars, whether they're combustible or EVs, to come into the city centre where we can help it. So what we've got there is the vehicles come in, they park up there, they're getting a charge for them going home. And right next to that hub, we see is a railway station, so you can get the train into the city centre, or even better than that, on the right-hand side, you can either walk or cycle. We've got a route path all the way down into the city centre. Again, making choices, leaving your EV there, and obviously the hierarchy of transportation has been met. And we're now installing electric bikes into that hub as well. So sometimes if you don't fancy pedaling like crazy, you've got some help. So that's what we developed. But we understood as well, and you'll be surprised to hear this, that although we're the sunniest city in Scotland, it is cold and wet some days. And you'd expect people to walk on those days. I wouldn't like it myself. So what we then looked at was the next slide, which shows you our multi-storey car parks, which are in the inner ring, the outer ring of the city, as you can see. And we started to develop. So if people are going to go into the city, we don't want them to take their vehicles into the city centre. We want them to use these car parks. And now what you're starting to develop, before I actually show you them, is that we're actually deciding where the transportation is going through the charging infrastructure. So for argument's sake, if we don't want to put charging infrastructure in our car park on the left-hand side of the city, we don't want the traffic coming, parking there at the right-hand east of the city, shall we say, car park, well, we'll change the tariffs and the parking so one's five times higher than the other, because that's where we want the vehicles to go. So you can understand now what you're looking at is infrastructure to move their transportation about the city, so avoiding gridlock and all the other issues that cities have. So the next slide on shows you what we have built on the multi-storey car parks, which was dynamic loaded charging infrastructure. So this again, you're seeing the solar on top of it, but this significantly has got 7 kilowatt chargers across the wall, as you can see there. But these chargers have the ability, if all these bays, say 20 cars pile in there at 8 o'clock in the morning, we know they're going to stay there for 8 hours, because there are long periods of time, because they're going to be working in the city centre. So the system can then reduce all the charging to 2-3 kilowatts, still giving them a charge over this longer period, but staying away from the grid significantly. On the right-hand side of that presentation, you see the Tesla charging battery storage system, slightly different from the ones you saw in the hub. The unique thing about these ones is they're always looking to, even though there might not be any cars that are getting charged because they've all stayed at the multi-modal hub, the system's always looking for to release that energy. So then it goes to, if there's no cars there, it'll go to the electricity for the multi-storey car park or the barrier system, etc. Significantly, again, what we have here is a overcapacity, and at that site, to then, as we go on, as the more numbers of EVs increase, we can increase the charging infrastructure. And what you see on the bottom right-hand side is significantly, with all that power that we'd already put in there, we're quite easily able to deploy a 150 kilowatt charge, you can see there. And this is actually a coach service that runs between Dundee and Edinburgh. There's two of these run in tandem, and that's a pure electric coach. Significantly, it is £7.50 to get to Edinburgh, as equivalent to a train, which is about £30. So that was, again, a byproduct of making sure that you've got enough energy there to increase your charging capacity. We move on now to, I talked earlier about how the 51% of the population don't have charging infrastructure, but we still, you know, as you can see, a lot of cars are parked outside people's houses in the streets. So there's a potential to get charging done at night. One of the things that we looked at was the lamppost charging, but unfortunately lamppost charging, we moved those lampposts back significantly a couple of years ago. And now what you would create if we did put them into a, some sort of charging infrastructure would be a trip hazard. So what we're now deploying across the city is pop-up chargers through an Innovate UK project and with Urban Foresight, a consultancy. And what we see these chargers doing is having the ability, and vandalism certainly is one of the things that we're looking to make sure doesn't happen. And also in areas, affluent areas, where they don't want unsightly, shall we say, chargers, again, this will go back into the pavement and out of the way. So we're looking at across different sectors of the city, and we think, I I've got the first one here where I'm speaking to you from, and I think there is a really exciting development, and I think it will increase the resident charging across many cities in the UK. If we move on to the next slide, what you can see is our future projects. You can see that I've just pointed out there's the bus, the coach that I just talked about, and that's since the 1st of October that's been running. We've also got electric HGVs coming. We've got two bin lorries. By the time I'm speaking to you, we'll have them here. We've already got large sweepers, electric, and minibuses. So I'll be honest, you can tell that I'd be enthusiastic about EVs. I think they work. I can't see any way that we're going back the way. I'm going to be pretty flippant about this. I know that the infrastructure works as chargers, the hardware. I know that the vehicles work. The key, again, I keep emphasising this, is what infrastructure you need. So on the sites where I've got this HGVs, I've put I'm making sure that all my buildings here have got solar on top of them. I'm making sure that the capacity here allows me to change my entire fleet of 40 bin lorries in over the next 8 years. So I have the capacity. It's just all about getting those vehicles as they come along. We have a international EV and hydrogen conference week happening in tandem with COP26 in November this year. Anybody wants to, you know, really quite interesting. It's through OLEV and the International Energy Association. Please get in touch with me if you want to be involved in that. Obviously, it's showcasing everything that we've done, but much more than that. And on the right-hand side there, we've now developing a fourth car park. We're looking at not only putting in infrastructure for cars, but also e-bikes, last-mile logistics. That's, as you can see, we've got the Police Scotland involved, universities, etc., and DC Thompson. So it's quite it's always evolving, shall we say, our infrastructure, as you can see. So the next, just moving, getting closer to the end, as you'll probably be happy to hear. This is basically trying to, and the next slide will show you that as well, that this is just, as I keep talking through the presentation, it's not just about cars and not just about charging infrastructure. It's about transportation, how we move about, mobility. And we are developing a booking app for our infrastructure. We're developing a mass project about how the transportation, how are you going to get to what we're showing here on the right-hand side, which is, as you can see, it's St Andrews. There happens to be a major open tournament happening in 2 years' time. And what we're working towards with all this infrastructure I've showed you, all this e-mobility, is how are we going to get 40,000 people per day, actually over the week it's 250,000 people, to that event, to a small town, using whether it's hydrogen, electric buses, electric cars, electric bikes, etc. How do you get to that event, major event? So it's a goal, it's something we're moving towards, and I think that all cities, when you're doing all this, if you have something that you're aiming for, it really is an it drives you on, as you can see. And plus, I like golf, I must admit. So yeah, the next one, second from the end, it's just showing you. I did that. So I just realised I did a flowchart. During lockdown to understand all the different projects that I was doing, and this is probably to keep my sanity. And it really was to try and. And this just emphasises everything joining up together. All the different projects. I have 21 different projects on the go, and it's how do you actually do this in a city? It takes a lot more, as I've pointed out, than just putting your own council fleet. But that's the driver, as long as we're showing you how it's done. And as you can see, a multitude of different projects are on the go. So that leads on to what I think is, again, something that's missed, and it's really quite crucial, which is all throughout this, you just don't go into this if you're going to half-heartedly go, I'll put some cars in, I'll put a charger in, that'll keep them happy. You must commit to this if you're going to do it properly, and you must make sure that people are always engaged and you're always communicating with them. I've talked to many places around the world. I've been lucky enough to talk about what we're doing, but it took us a wee while to understand that. I showed you the screen of the Princes Street. People were going by in the bus in Dundee and going, I wonder what that lovely thing is, and then off to work they went. It took me a wee while to realise that people in Dundee knew less than, say, somebody in Amsterdam about what we're doing in Dundee. So we have now a major campaign. We call it Drive Dundee Electric, but we, in our local newspaper, we do a double spread of media coverage about all the things that I've talked about, all the things that we're going to be doing, and we constantly market it and we constantly meet everybody to just show everybody, look, this is what we're doing. This is the reason why we're doing it. And that has been crucial to make sure we've got focus groups, et cetera, et cetera. But you must keep on top of that in order to try and get people to basically, for them to move, make the changes. It's easier if they make the decision rather than people telling them to do that. The Scots, for example, hate getting told what to do. They'd more like make that decision themselves. So, lastly, it's just a slide to say, I mean, this is showing you that we won an award. We're very happy about this one, which was the EV Association of Scotland nominated us as an e-visionary city for Europe. And this award was given to us in Japan, in Kobe, Japan. Very proud of that. When it comes from the EV Association, you'd like to think that the users, if they're happy with it, we're doing something right. So that's fantastic. And lastly, in GQ magazine, Dundee was called the coolest little city in Britain. And I'm not really sure whether that's to do with the temperature here or whether that's actually to do with being a really good place to live. But my personal opinion is it's a fantastic place to live. So please, if you get an opportunity after these terrible times are finished with this virus, please, if you have an opportunity, please come up to Dundee, and I'm very happy to show you what I've just shown you. Thank you very much.
Well, thanks, Fraser, and good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this live Q&A session on electric vehicle procurement and electric vehicle management. I'm Steve Bryars, Editor-in-Chief at Fleet News, and I'm delighted to be joined by our session speaker, Fraser Crichton, Corporate Fleet Operations Manager at Dundee City Council. And from our sponsor, we have David Bushnell, Principal Consultant at Alphabet, and Seb Bilek, Business Development Manager UK at NewMotion, which is Alphabet's EV charging partner. So this is a chance for the audience to ask questions. We've got quite a few questions coming in already. Fraser, if I start with you, that was an excellent insight into the EV and EV procurement from one of the UK's most progressive cities. When you're looking at your own fleet, how did Dundee City Council profile its drivers and its vehicles that were best suited to make that initial switch across to electric vehicles?
Yeah, it was, well, obviously, as the fleet manager, we constantly, even before EVs started to come onto the market, we were constantly trying to understand
the sort of mileage. So we knew the mileage that the vehicles were doing. We knew the operations that they were doing. And obviously, when you start bringing in EVs, that's the key to understanding. How many miles does it do operationally? How much weight can the vehicles hold, etc.? And then all you do is you just profile that against the information that you do have. So at the beginning, as I say, way back 10 years ago, we kind of could see that 30% of our operations could take those early EVs adoption. And as the batteries have increased, obviously the ability to change over to EV cars, vans, medium vans, become greater. I have set a commitment for the end of 2022 for all my cars, medium and small vans, to be fully electric, which is about 480 vehicles.
And David, do you have any further advice for those fleets that are looking at identifying the types of drivers that would be best suited to make that move across to electric?
Yeah, absolutely, Stephen. And Fraser, I think it's really fantastic to see what you've done in Dundee. I wish that was the template that other authorities were adopting. I think certainly the first thing really to do is to drill into that duty cycle. What is that vehicle actually doing? Now, that can be done in a variety of ways. Just taking we've got to change into driving patterns at the moment, but just looking at the average daily mileage that vehicle is doing. And I think that will give you some surprises about what people are actually achieving in the vehicles. If not, use the telematics data that you may have available, or if not, part of the Alpha Electric consulting is that we can actually put in little data loggers into existing ICE vehicles and start to understand what that journey is. We can take that data and then analyze it and actually critically see who can go now, who may be viable, or actually with some changes, who could move over. So yeah, getting that duty cycle analysis is absolutely critical to understanding who can move to electrics easily.
Now, a lot of fleets have looked at the cost of electric vehicles, or certainly the price on the bonnet, and possibly have put them off a little bit. But you know, can you model the ideal time or the sort of mileage operating cycle to find that sweet spot where electric vehicles become more cost effective compared to a petrol or diesel alternative? Fraser, I'll come to you first, and then to David.
So certainly, how I would start off on purchasing is probably key for me. I mean, one of the things that I always look at, and I use the example of your mobile phone. The technology of electric vehicles is constantly evolving. The batteries are constantly increasing. So I'm tending to find that most of my vehicles that I buy in cars and small vans are leased. I do it through leasing because I do 3-year leases, because in 3 years' time, what your electric vehicle looks like now is completely changed. You've got a mileage is going to increase maybe by 100 miles at least. So I tend to lease them, but certainly the information that we have gathered over the years, where when you are owning them, those vehicles, for argument's sake, you've got to start putting in understanding that you're now about 30%, 35% less maintenance and service costs in an electric vehicle, most crucially. And what we're also finding is generally drivers are actually driving them better as opposed to a combustible engine, where they're all automatic, and instead of ramming the gears and driving fast, they're actually smoothing. And a lot, it sounds a wee bit hippie, I must admit, Stephen, to keep with me, but it actually relaxes the drivers. If you talk to anybody who's driven an electric vehicle for a long time, it relaxes them. And what we're finding with the plumbers or joiners or construction guys, we're actually finding less accidents happening with them. That's the evidence that we've got coming through. So you've got to add all those things in and look at the whole life costs. And once you start doing that, I would say on a typical van, something like a Peugeot Partners, something like that, equivalent NV200 electric, it's about 2 years, we're seeing payback. It's as early as that now. So really start looking at your fleet, and I think you'll be surprised at how many EVs you can actually add to your fleets.
And David?
Yeah, I think I'd echo that. I think the driver fatigue bit is absolutely critical here. I mean, driving in a city with a manual transmission and a heavy clutch, I've got out of cars, my left leg's been dead at the end of the day. So I think certainly that we're starting to see those efficiencies come in as well. But the mantra, as Fraser alluded to, is whole life cost or TCO analysis is, again, absolutely critical here. And then overlaying that with, look, if you're paying 10, 11, 12, 15p per mile for a diesel or petrol, where's that tipping point at 2, 3 or 4p for the electric? Because I'll be honest with you, if the vehicle's not being utilized, you know, it's very low mileage, then that dependency on the fuel saving isn't always going to be there. You've got to make sure the utilization is high enough to justify the move as well as the TCO analysis. But, you know, that's, again, if you're not using whole life cost to evaluate these vehicles, that is your first step on the journey.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Seb on this next question. We've had a lot of questions around charging infrastructure. So I'll start with Seb and then I'll go on to Fraser for some of the detail about what he's done with Dundee. So Seb, how would you go about calculating how many workplace chargers that you might require if you're starting to bring electric vehicles onto your fleet, and the charging speed that you need, and, you know, and where these charge points should go?
Yeah, I think it's a really good question. I think in terms of the first step in figuring out what and how many charge points you need at a business, you've got to understand, you know, certain vehicles pull certain amounts of charge. So, you know, it's not as simple as let's put some 22 kilowatts in and everything charges at 22 kilowatts. Unfortunately, I wish it was. But, you know, it's working out, you know, is it a very full EV fleet? Is it a hybrid fleet? A lot of businesses seem to think and seem to be of the way that, okay, they need to be future ready, which is great. But there's multiple different ways of being future ready without spending on heavy charge points. And of course, you've got, you know, rapid chargers, as Fraser mentioned, in certain situations with depots, works really well. And you know, like you say, if it's there's been an issue overnight or whatever, you can have that quick power charge. But I think, you know, you can make probably 75% to 80% of your fleet work on, you know, your typical fast chargers up to 22. In terms of, you know, how many right now to put into your offices, I think the key thing is not so much how many, but how ready you make it for the future. So, for example, if you have, you know, 4 charge points in now, you need to, you know, for cost purposes, make sure that you're actually able to then add on fairly easily. And I think that's where most companies kind of put, you know, 6 in now. And then actually, when they want to start putting on more, they've got to work their way back to the distribution board or back to where that power is. So there's different ways of future proofing. It doesn't necessarily have to be huge kilowattage right now, but being able to just carry on producing that daisy chain is where you need to be as a business for most of your depots, especially employee parking.
And Fraser, is that your own experience, you know, that kind of need to future-proof your charging network, knowing where you were looking to go with the fleet?
Yeah, Seb's point there is spot on. I think I mentioned it quite a lot in the presentation. You really need to think to yourself, like, how many vehicles do I have here? I understand that at this moment in time, I can't change them all, but what's the future looking? I think another thing I'm starting to see is the assumption that people say, right, I've got 10 vans or 10 cars at this site, therefore I need 10 chargers. That's not the case. I mean, you it's back to the conversation right at the start. What is your operational cycle? Do you need, so if you can work out that your van only needs to be charged twice a week, so therefore it only needs two charges a week, therefore, you know, do the calculations and work out that you might only need 4 or 5 chargers as opposed to your 10. What I tend to see is people looking at it and thinking, right, I've got 10 vans, I need 10 spaces, and I need 10 chargers. And then you need the amount of power for that. I think it's back to the conversation that Dave was saying before. What are your cycles? Understand what your vehicles, what it requires, and then that will dictate what much charging that you're needing.
So Fraser, I've got a few questions about the public chargers. To start off with the utilisation, how frequently are they in use? How often are they idle? And also, how do people pay for them? Is it just a simple debit card?
Okay, that's quite a lot of questions in one go there, but I'll go for it. So to understand the hubs, the three hubs, before lockdown, there was 120,000 sessions over the year. I think it was actually 10 months. Roughly, the rapid chargers in the hubs are being used at their peak about 35 times a day. So that understands it's quite a lot. It's quite significant. The taxi industry obviously use them quite a bit. They're main. We've got delivery companies and businesses. On tariffs, one thing I would say is if you're just starting off in your journey, please put tariffs straight away. We didn't do that. We waited and then start putting tariffs on. And the Scots are probably even worse than anyone else in the world about having to pay for anything. And to suddenly go from nothing to only 15 pence a kilowatt, we've managed to keep it very low because we want to still encourage it, which is quite significantly low because we're subsidising it through other things. It has been problematic moving from there to there. So we're sitting at 15 as a connection fee of 38 pence, which is quite significant. We're trying to get that down. And significantly, what we've seen is with that introduction, for instance, the taxis would come in for 6 to 8 minutes and there'd be opportunist charging. What we've now seen with putting the chargers in and putting a connection fee in is that is 10 to 12 minutes. They're starting to then charge, and that's a significant change that you have to monitor. As far as the question around, how do they charge? So the most expensive way to charge is to do it by your card, swipe card, because there's bank charges here. So the majority of businesses, companies that are using it get charged on a monthly basis. They actually have the tariffs stacked. And if they stack them up over that month, they get a period and obviously reduces the cost. And that's the cheapest way. What we find is that people coming into the city, for instance, it's going to see the V&A, they will use a credit card or they will pay that way. And they'll pay that extra. So that will kind of come to it. So it's a mix and match. But if people living in Dundee tend to use this monthly stacking system paid on a monthly basis, which is the cheapest.
And are the charge points pre-bookable?
So that is what we're at this moment in time we're working on. There's quite a lot of stuff going on. We're actually building a fourth hub, and that will have significantly charges only for the taxi industry. But I'm also putting in sensors, parking sensors on every parking bay across the infrastructure. And we're working on an app at this moment in time. We've just procured it. Through because we've got quite a advanced gaming industry in Dundee. If anybody doesn't know it, Grand Theft Auto came from Dundee. So we're not that I'm expecting that to happen, but we're building an app to pre-book everything because that is the next stage. Because obviously, one thing I don't have in Dundee is I don't have icing. I don't have combustible vehicles because all of our infrastructure is deemed as called car parks, and we call them the car parks because we've got TROs on them, traffic orders against every parking. So our parking team in Dundee who run about in electric vehicles then enforce that, and I'll be honest, I do not have any issues because we've got those. Everyone knows if you're more than 4 hours on an electric vehicle, you will get ticketed. So you've got enforcement behind it all, and you need that as well. So I really don't have that issue as well, icing, which is quite common in all other places.
And how is the electric vehicle infrastructure paid for?
So we've got grants from, we've got OLEV, the Scottish Government have constantly given us money over the 10 years. We did get a go ultra low, just short of £2 million to build the hubs, but all the other infrastructure has been Transport Scotland over the years giving us, and all the other councils in Scotland. And we've also had European money, and we've also used our own, to be honest. We've also used council's own money. We've match funded it as well. As I say, and I showed you in the presentation, our leadership is driving this way. They want us to go this way. So they've not only accepted, we've taken a lot of money from outside, but we've also used our own. It's very helpful when you've got a council like that.
I suppose same to Dave and Seb, is there still plenty of money grants available to businesses that are looking to implement EVs and EV infrastructure?
Yeah. I think the whole key to this, sorry, just to finish it, is if you've got a plan, a strategy, if you come with something, if you just turn around and say, I want some EV stuff, then the money won't flow. But I think, you know, that's my point on it. Sorry, okay. Dave.
No, that's quite all right. I think it's very encouraging to see what the government support is, and certainly sort of the expected announcements tomorrow, etc. We want to see that investment continue. Yeah, infrastructure still needs money, but it's helping the home and the workplace charging and where these vehicles are going to sit for the majority of time to make sure that works for the majority, not the minority.
Okay, I mean, that Q&A session just whistled by. We've still got quite a few questions, so I'd like to just remind visitors that they can head across to the networking lounge to continue a conversation with any of those speakers. But we'll have to wrap up now. Also, I can remind visitors that if you'd like to find out more about operating an efficient fleet, you should head over to the experts on the Alphabet stand, where you can see David and Seb again to have those conversations. And you can actually read all about Dundee's move to e-mobility in the December issue of Fleet News, where we've interviewed Fraser on many of these things that he's been talking about today. So next up, you can hear from Volvo about how it's recharging its business with electric and plug-in hybrid cars. But for now, my thanks to Fraser, David and Seb. And enjoy the rest of the show, everyone.